All right, welcome to a brand new segment on the show. I don't really have a name for it yet. Music trivia against the musician? I don't know. That's a working title. Each week, we'll come up with a better name. Stay tuned. On the phone right now is a listener named Alanna. Hey, Alanna, how are you?
I'm great. How are you?
I'm pretty good. Where do you live?
I live in Arlington, Virginia, just outside D.C.
Oh, cool. Well, do you feel like you're pretty proficient in music?
I guess. I don't know. It depends on what a category.
Yeah, that's the deal. It's pretty tough because Adam Hambrick's here, too, who we're just going to say is a guy at this point. Because you only get to talk about what you do if you win. Like, that's what you're playing for.
Okay.
Your promotion is if you win.
Deal.
Her deal, if she wins, she wins $50, and I Venmo it to her immediately.
Ooh.
So, Adam Hambrick right now, just my friend who stopped by.
Just a guy.
So
just
that's
a bro.
But that's why you want to win.
That's why I want to win.
Because we have, you know, a million people listen to this thing a month, and you want to make sure that from those lips, they get to hear what you're working on right now.
Free advertisement.
That's right. All right, Alanna, so what are you doing right outside of D.C.?
I work at a professional organization association.
That is the most generic term for a job I've ever heard. A professional association of organizations. What is it again?
It's a professional association for country club managers.
Okay. Ah. You're a spy, aren't you? That's always what they say. They're like, you know, I work at an organization of places. Yeah, what does that mean?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, well, you are a spy. It's the first spy we've ever had on the show. So you'll each get 5 questions. And I have a whole other set in case there is a tie.
Okay.
Now, Adam, since you're the celebrity, you get to pick. Do you want to go first or second?
I'll go second.
Okay.
Ladies first.
You're up first, Alanna. You get your first question. Which country singer, which famous country singer wrote Patsy Cline's hit, Crazy?
Willie Nelson?
Correct. Wow.
Boom.
Wow. Look at her. She comes out swinging. Adam Hambrick. Who was the first country artist to sell over 10 million copies of an album?
Garth Brooks.
Correct. It's his self-titled debut album.
It's a good one.
We are at 1-1. Alanna, which song by the band Survivor was the theme song for the 1982 movie Rocky III? The band was Survivor. They put out a song in 1982. What was that song?
Oh, gosh.
5 seconds.
I don't think I know.
You know it's going to bum you out when you miss it.
I know. Oh,
time is up. We put a little clock on you in case you try to Google, which we know you would never do because you are a professional organization of management associates, and that is not what you guys are about. That is Eye of the Tiger. It's the Eye of the Tiger, ready to fight. Come on, you know that. All right, Adam.
Yes.
Which country legend, a member of the Grand Ole Opry since 1991, was hired by the Eagles following the death of Glenn Frey?
It was definitely Vince Gill.
It was Vince.
Oh, yeah.
That is correct. Adam takes the lead by 1. Alanna, which artist whose hits include Born to Run and Glory Days has the nickname The Boss? His nickname?
Frank?
Correct.
Yeah, there you go. There you go.
Adam Hambrick, which famous composer created some of his greatest music while he was going deaf?
Beethoven.
Correct.
Boom.
Was that a guess, or did you feel pretty confident about that?
No. felt good about
you
it.
You had the tone of Beethoven?
Beethoven?
Alanna, which music icon began his career as a member of the group The Wailers? Which music icon began his career as a member of the group? They were called the Wailers. 5 seconds.
I have no idea.
The answer was Bob Marley. That's incorrect. Bob Marley and the Wailers. Yeah.
Darn it.
Adam, which two country singers teamed up for the 2003 hit Beer for My Horses?
Oh, that would be Toby Keith. And Willie Nelson, y'all.
He's not gonna miss one, folks.
That's a great song. That's one of my favorite country songs of that decade, to be honest.
Alanna, which British singer teamed up with Queen in 1981 for the hit Under Pressure?
Oh, man.
Paul McCartney?
That's incorrect.
It was Vanilla Ice. That's who it was. Vanilla Ice.
It was David Bowie. Alanna, you didn't win, but man, you played a heck of a game. You came out strong. When you hit that first one and you knew Willie Nelson wrote Crazy, I thought, we got a contender.
Yeah, because I didn't know that one. I was, I felt ashamed of my country fanhood for a second.
Well, Alanna, you did not win $50, but that is very cool to have you on the show. What's happening today at work?
Not a whole lot. Working from home, quarantine in a way. It's a new world.
Yeah. You wearing a mask when you go out?
Yes, absolutely.
Nice. I did a poll on Twitter and on Facebook because I wanted to see the demographic difference in when I asked about masks. Because, listen, I don't like to wear a mask, but I do it because it's most likely the socially responsible thing to do.
Yep.
So, and if you just say most likely, that it's most likely going to help somebody, I'm all in. Because I would want somebody to most likely help me. Because I can't prove what goes out through a mask.
Yep.
But what I'm listening to is most scientists. You know, the overwhelming amount of scientists are saying this isn't the end all be all. But if you wear one and they wear one, there is the probability that it could stop in the middle of that somewhere.
For sure.
And so, Mike, what was my point? I don't know. I got into a whole little pivot there. I don't even know what I was talking about. Oh, no. I got it. So I put on Twitter and Facebook to see the difference in demographics. And on Twitter, I said, hey, just taking a poll of the folks that are following me here. Should we be wearing masks? Do you wear a mask? And it was, I think, 85-15. And so I posted that on my Instagram story. And a lot of people said, well, if you do that on Facebook, you're going to see that Facebook's probably 60-40 the other way. And I was like, I don't think so. Like, I have faith in most humans. And so I put it on Facebook, and it was a bit different because it definitely skews, as Twitter does, to the left a bit and being progressive.
Yep.
Facebook does the same thing to the right of being conservative. But it was still only then 75-25. So I was actually pretty proud of those results for Twitter and Facebook, the most left and the most right, being pretty right on with each other.
Yep.
So anyway, all that to say, Alanna, good for you. I'm proud of that. Thank you for playing. Hope you have a great day at work, and it was really cool talking to you.
Yeah, thanks for having me. Appreciate it.
All right, there she is. We'll say goodbye to her now. Well, now comes the part of the show that we have to do. What? So Adam just told me he lives, we're not going to say where. Somebody found my address and is already sending me fan mail. I've moved. How in the world can somebody find out where I live already?
Dude, I don't know. The world's a crazy place.
Everything is supposedly locked down.
Quote, unquote.
Yeah. But
Internet's wild.
So if you find me, just know that Adam lives within 5 miles of me now. he came over and was like, dang, I live super close to you. So what are you guys doing? Is your wife still working?
She's working.
In hospitals?
Yeah, she works at some of the walk-in clinics for Vanderbilt.
Are they testing COVID?
They are. She's doing a lot of that testing, man. It's been pretty intense.
Do you get a discount on tests?
Do
I get a discount? Family?
We buy in bulk.
Yeah. See, every night?
No, I think they do a thing for their employees, but I don't think it extends to family. So,
have you been tested?
I have not been tested.
Dang.
And so, but she's done like the antibody test, and she came back like didn't have any of the antibodies. Like she hasn't had it at all. So that's a big win for us.
I got tested 3 days ago, and it really wasn't as intense as some make it seem.
Was it a brain tickle, or because now they do it a little bit farther out, where you don't have to go all the way up into your.
It wasn't a brain tickle, but it definitely wasn't the swab in the top of the nose.
Okay.
Like, it went deep enough where I was like, oh.
Yeah.
But people act like they stick that thing, into your nose and it comes out your pee-pee hole. Like, it makes whole circle there.
I mean, my wife's tested people and they've passed, who've passed
really?
Out. Yeah.
Maybe they've just gotten a little better at doing the test.
Maybe so. I don't know.
So, we've all been locked up. What have you been working on?
Dude, I've been working on music. Which has been awesome.
Does that mean writing music or like actually
both.
Producing some stuff?
Both. So we like there were three songs that we cut during quarantine, and we just kind of like went back and forth, like me and my producer Andrew DeRoberts. We just kind of like ping pong back and forth. Like I would send a guitar vocal and he would build the track, and I'd come back and like do final vocals.
Where are you doing these in your house? Do you have a little setup there?
You know, I do. Yeah, I have a little setup. We just moved this summer, and the house we were in, I just had a little fold-up card table in the corner of our small bedroom, and I had to like pick it up and take it down. Now I got a little space in the new spot, and so we just been cutting vocals on some tracks. Got some new stuff coming next month that I'm really excited about.
So this is in August or September?
Sorry,
is that me or you?
That was me. In August.
So what's the What's the plan? Is it going to be you putting out three new songs at once?
No. So we're going to do kind of a series. I'm calling them flip sides. Two song drops, and we're gonna put the first one out at the end of August, and it's called Top Down Southbound. It's a series, just two songs, and we're going to do a series of these through the end of the year and top of the spring, and we're excited about it. Excited to finally put out like some new music that we're really pumped about.
If someone doesn't know your music and everything that's up streaming right now, what's the one song? Michael, pull it up here. What's the one song you would be like, this song right now best personifies who I am as an artist? What's the one song people can stream right now?
The one song, I would probably say All You, All Night, All Summer.
Good thing for us, Mike has it ready to go.
Boom. Small town, I was all you were all mine. The high tees was like a
feast. Are you doing anything virtual where you're actually being able to make a little money at all?
You know, I haven't done that because I'm still a new artist. I haven't like fully developed the audience yet where I feel like somebody's gonna pay $20 to watch me play songs from my office.
Right.
You know. But kind of starting to build into that with this release. We're gonna do some more virtual shows, and do some more live streams and all that stuff. So yeah, we're all fired right. up.
Follow him, Adam Hambrick. You can build that fan base he's talking about that he
Let's
doesn't
go.
Have yet.
Let's go.
He should have it, though. Adam Hambrick, that's it. Hey, you win. You're 1-0.
You know what? I feel really good about that because you texted me last night, and I was like, you know, I don't know if I actually know music trivia or if I'm just in music. Like, there's a, you know, because I didn't grow up the biggest music fan. It wasn't really, I don't think.
How do you grow up not a music fan?
Well, it's weird. My family, they're musical people, and we sang songs in church, but I wasn't like introduced to like music at large, like popular music and stuff, until like high school and college, and so like some of that stuff just kind of came by way of being around.
But when did you start learning how to play music?
Just in the church.
Like what age?
I sang my whole life, but then I started playing guitar when I was 12.
So that's early?
Yeah.
Like I didn't get introduced to any sort of music playing, which compared to you, I don't, but I do enough to be able to,
yeah,
you know, perform and especially do comedy.
Yep.
Until, I went to a pawn shop when I was 18 or 19 and,
yeah,
and bought a Walmart page and played chords. So I would say you were introduced way earlier than I was, but it was just the radio, man.
Yeah, that was all. I knew the songs on the radio, but like we didn't have Google back then. So we were like, it's Tracy Lawrence, Pay Me at Birmingham, you know, like, but you don't know who wrote the song or who, you know, so it was kind of different. I just listened to the radio. That was the extent of my music.
What was your station growing up? The top three stations in the format growing up?
Kiss of 96 and Little Rock. That was it. That was the only station we listened to.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah.
So Kiss of 96 is one of mine too. Yeah. It probably wouldn't be it would be one of the biggest, but Bob Robbins did Mornings
Bob
forever.
Robbins, man.
And I'm on that station now.
Yeah.
So, you know, Kiss of 96. Cool 95 out of Little Rock was an oldie station that I listened to all the time.
Yep.
I mean, I think that's why I feel pretty strong with music from the late 50s all the way up to probably the early 70s. I kind of lose some of that late 70s, early 80s.
Yep.
I'm kind of out a little bit when it starts to go to the REO Speedwagon stuff.
Oh, yeah.
That's because that wasn't on oldies, and it also wasn't new, which was 90s for me. So it wasn't history, and it wasn't present. It was kind of this weird purgatory of music I never cared about getting into.
Yep.
But it was the pop station, KLAZ, which my first radio station ever worked on.
Yep. That was a good one too. So I grew up a lot in Mississippi. So like when I was really young, till I was like 8 years old, we lived in Arkansas, and it was all country. And then I moved to Mississippi, and they didn't even really have like any radio stations really like in the town.
What town?
Corinth.
What was it near?
It was about an hour from Tupelo. And so we could kind of get a Tupelo station, but, you know, there was no pop radio.
Man, that would suck if there was no radio.
Yeah.
If you're in such a rural area that you're not even close enough to a tower from a metropolitan area.
Yep. So I just had tapes, you know, at that point. So we just had, like, I had Garth No Fences on a bootleg, you know, that my uncle gave me. And then, you know, like, I would get a tape every Christmas, and it was usually Alan Jackson.
You know, what we would do is I would hit up some friends, and they would hit me up too, but I didn't have as cool of stations to them. But I had friends in Dallas who I would be like, hey, man, take a tape and just record an hour of The Edge and then flip it around and just record an hour of The Edge and then mail it to me.
Yep.
Because you couldn't listen on the internet. There was no streaming.
There was nothing like that.
And so they would take a blank cassette and just record an hour of The Edge.
Back in my day.
Yeah, that's what we are now.
Yeah, 100%.
And I would get that tape, and it would be commercials and everything. And I, you know, the first time I would listen all the way through just to the whole hour. But then after that, I would go through songs.
Yep.
But it was like the Stabbing Westward live. It was all that version of alternative music. And I was like, I got a tape from The Edge. This is so freaking cool. Oh, man. Hey, Mike, so how old are you?
29.
Can you remember non-streaming radio?
Yeah.
Okay. I don't really know where that cutoff is.
Yeah.
Where it's when you had to listen to radio stations.
Yeah.
And not just radio stations, but you had to listen to them terrestrially through a tower.
Yep. Yep.
So
I think it was when I was in college was the first time I was able to listen to
streaming.
Anything streamed from somewhere else. It was like late college too.
Nah. Yeah, no walk, but whatever. Adam, good to see you, man.
Good to see you too. Thanks for having me.
What's going on with you this weekend?
This weekend, I was supposed to go to a wedding, and so my wife and my oldest daughter, who's a flower girl, they went to Oklahoma City, and so I got the baby now, and we're here because I have a TV thing, a super down low TV thing that I have to not get COVID before.
I'm in the
before
same.
I go. So
it's funny
I'm just
you say
low.
That because yeah. I can't get. I've been laying low too because my Nat Geo show is supposed to start next week. We just got delayed again, but they're like, you can't get COVID.
Yeah.
Because the whole production shuts down.
Yep.
So I haven't been to the gym.
Yep.
And I own 3 gyms, and I feel like we do the safest. But I'm so hyper. That's why I got tested too.
Yeah.
Honestly.
Yeah, for sure.
Because Eddie got it.
Yeah.
Tim, my head security guy, got it.
What?
They all got it on vacation. Like, we went away, and apparently they just went butt wild in COVID land. Like, Bobby's away.
I talked to Eddie this week. He said he was being super careful.
He wasn't.
He said he...
Bullcrap.
is he a liar?
You don't say you're super careful when you go to Florida for vacation. Love Florida. And
you just roll the windows down driving through, and you get it.
And they're a big part of why I've been able to have the success I have, just Florida in general. However, I think they would all admit, too, it's pretty bad down there. Like, Florida and California is a real struggle right now for COVID.
Yeah.
But Eddie's like, we're going on vacation. We're going to the beach. And the funny part was Lunchbox and Raymundo from the radio show went to Vegas for Raymundo's bachelor party. Yeah. Eddie and I stayed away. We're not, can't get COVID. I had the TV show to worry about.
Yep.
Eddie's like, you guys are going to get COVID. Ha, ha, ha. And then he goes to Florida, comes back. And is like, he called me. And was like, I'm positive.
I got COVID.
He said, I have coronavirus.
Coronavirus. He's the full term.
But yeah, like you, I'm not allowed to get it, or it just delays not only my job in recording, but all the crew.
Yeah, there's so many jobs and so many people who are like counting on stuff, and they're just like so tentatively doing the TV stuff, and that's the thing. Like if you show up on set and you have COVID, they shut everything down. Millions of dollars down the tube. People don't have jobs anymore. It's a thing. So you have to be real careful.
With us, it's as soon as if I get on an airplane, I have to get tested as soon as I land.
Yep.
And then I have to wait 24 hours for that test.
Yep.
So then I have to get to the set a day early. And then once I get the negative, I get to go into the shooting 3-day bubble. Because as soon as you're in the bubble, you don't get to leave.
Yep.
So then we go into the bubble because we have the bureaucracy of Disney.
Yep.
Nat Geo. Because Disney owns Nat Geo, but they're two different entities as well. And BBC, which is my production company that I'm working with. So we're just like, and good for them, but it's just a pain in the butt.
Yeah, and they all have different processes.
Yeah, we got to go through all of them.
Dang.
So, but we're supposed to go to Montana, not next week, but I think the week after that now.
Are you allowed to say where in Montana?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, I have the whole...
Montana's awesome.
Let me see. I'm going to near Bozeman.
Okay.
But I have the entire, like I was supposed to go do a wrestle these female wrestlers. They're professional wrestlers.
Oh my gosh.
But COVID shut down that idea. She's a stunt woman and a wrestler. And we're going to be a tag team and wrestle two other wrestlers, female wrestlers. But they were like, this is like, you can't wrestle during COVID.
You want to hear something funny? Fifth grade me swore up and down I was going to be a professional wrestler. That's what I wanted to do with my life when I was in fifth grade.
Who was your guy?
You know, I love the 1980s, 1990s cartoonish, like WWF, WWE.
Like full steroid guys.
Full steroids.
Yeah.
Hulk Hogan, Macho Man. Like,
you had to pick one guy, though.
I was stereotypical.
Who was your one guy?
I mean, it was probably Hulk Hogan. Like, as stereotypical.
Generic.
Yeah, as generic. It's just like, I just, when he made that flip and went to WCW, I was like, I'm all in.
I was way into wrestling then too. I was a blonde haired Sting guy though.
Oh yeah, blonde haired Sting's.
Because I was young, you know, when he went to the black haired Sting, it got a little weird.
Yeah,
I liked it. He was like the Scorpion. Yeah.
But yeah, we never saw enough of him after that. He came in and did a couple things.
He'd like come from the Raptors and then go back.
Yep.
But yeah, Sting. And in my first book that I wrote a thing about Sting, and he signed. He I don't know how he got a copy of it, but he signed the book and said, "Hey, thanks, man. Sent me my own book back."
Oh,
he signed over the part.
That's incredible.
And so did Mark Grace, who's my favorite baseball player of all time, because I'm a big Cubs fan.
Yep.
All right, listen, we've gone on and on.
We have.
Everybody be safe. We have an interview with Ruthie Collins coming up in a second. You familiar with Ruthie Collins?
Yep, big fan of her voice.
Are you?
She's fantastic.
I have never seen her play. I've only listened to her on Instagram, listened to her music. Met her twice now. I went up to her in the airport. I think we touched on this briefly, but I saw her, and she's really good friends with Natalie Stovall, who
yep,
I'm obviously super close to.
Yep.
And Nikita Carmen, who I mean, I freaking brought from Australia to the States. They run really tight, but I'd never met Ruthie. And I went up and I was like, "Hey, I feel like I know you. I just wanted to come and say hi." And she goes, "Oh, we met before." And I was like, "Oh, I'm such a douche. I didn't remember, but that's just how douchey I am."
Yeah, I get it.
Apparently, it was at St. Jude, like my first year in town.
Yeah.
So that to be I was fair, a little overwhelmed that's a, by the whole thing.
Long time.
Yeah.
Long
All right. Time. So Ruthie Collins coming
also,
up.
Also,
go ahead.
Ask Ruthie about.
I've already done the interview.
Oh, that was it. Good talk.
I can't. Dude. We did the. It's a podcast, Adam. It all has to be live. He thinks we have her on the phone, ready to go. What were you gonna tell me to ask?
I was gonna
her
tell
about?
You. She had met me. Like we kind of known each other. It was like right after I moved to town, and I show up. We're playing the show, and I'm in the round with her. But then she comes up to me and she gives me a big hug and she goes, "Scott, I'm so glad you're here. You're late." And I said, first off, I'm not late. Second off, I'm not Scott." and her bass player walks in. His name's Scott Mulvihill.
Doppelganger?
Looking just like me. And I'm like, no, this cannot be.
Did you ever play early when you moved to town around? And when you look back, you're like, "Oh, it was really cool. I got to play around with that person before they kind of popped."
Oh, yeah.
Like before they were anything. But who was that?
My first round at the Bluebird, it was hilarious because I like literally had a rider truck full of my crap from Arkansas, like pulled up behind the Bluebird, got out of the rider truck, came in and played around. And it was an ASCAP like discovery kind of round. It was me and Kelsey Ballerini and Forrest Whitehead, who
produces Kelsey.
Yeah.
Or did.
Yeah.
I don't know if he still does, but yeah, definitely did.
Yeah.
Is he doing music?
Yeah.
You know Forrest? Is
oh,
he
yeah
doing music his own thing now?
I mean, he's just producing and writing.
Okay.
Yeah.
I don't know if
he's amazing. I've written a bunch of great songs with Forrest.
All right. We are now done. Let's go here, take a break, and then I'll ask Ruthie about Scott. We'll just insert it in. All right, here you go. Follow Adam at Adam Hambrick. The one thing you should, it will give you good luck if you follow Adam today on Instagram.
I like that.
At Adam Hambrick. If you don't, you'll have bad luck.
Bad luck.
And I'm putting that on you right now, but if you do, you'll have great luck.
Like a broken mirror.
That's right. All right, thanks, guys.
Hey, guys, it's Bobby Bones. Welcome to the channel. If you're new to the channel, subscribe and then go check it out. A lot of artists, a lot of songwriters, a lot of music. Welcome to the Bobby Cash channel.